I'm in the morning, and it's 5 minutes after the hour. Coming up, Snoop, upside your head on the Riddick Bowe situation. Tony Kornheiser in the Washington Post this morning with a pretty amusing column, some of it devoted to Riddick Bowe's. Well, it sounds to me like he was kicked out of the Marine Corps, doesn't it?
It sounds very, according to this fellow, the major, who's a spokesman at Parris Island, he wanted to correct that impression that he had left voluntarily.
Yeah, that he wouldn't cooperate. Had an attitude, and was just a big nitwit.
Yep.
And then General George S. Patton on, also on Riddick Bowe and on Kenneth Starr. Not a happy situation there.
No.
For either one of them, is it?
No, it's not.
And Charles and I are speculating on who Lolly Weymouth was talking to, this big-time columnist who told her that this was the most corrupt administration, the Clinton administration, ever.
In the history of our nation.
And we think that it's probably either David Broder.
Mm-hmm. Or?
Well, it's probably David Broder. What do you think? I mean, it could be somebody not from her paper.
But it could be. As you suggested, it might be Mr. Sapphire, but probably David Broder. It's a good suspect.
Wish she'd have told us.
Yeah, darn it.
Well,
leaving us hanging out here, wondering.
Well, I asked her anyway. Thought maybe I could trick her.
Sure.
Obviously, she got up a little early and had a couple cups of coffee and wasn't going to be tricked.
No, Mr.
Disc jockey.
Some old doofus
on the radio.
All right. It's time for the national news, and here with that is Charles McCoy. Good morning, Chuck.
Good morning, I-Man. And one of the stories to which Ms. Weymouth alluded, in the Washington Post, China Advisor's Gift to DNC under review. And it says the Democratic National Committee is prepared this week to return dozens, of additional political contributions that were questioned in a still confidential internal audit of party fundraising. At least one of the donations now under review came from a foreign developer who holds an advisory post with China's communist government, according to documents. And this would be the first time that this sort of thing would be linked to anyone with an official tie to the Chinese government. That was one of the stories that Ms. Weymouth was referring to. Then, moving on to the New York Times, President Clinton was the star attraction at a dinner last night for donors to the Democratic National Committee, each of whom had paid at least $10,000 to join the Democratic Business Council. And writes the Times, it was Mr. Clinton's third fundraiser of the year that once again placed himself in the paradoxical position of furthering a practice he has said he hopes to outlaw. Most of it was unregulated soft money, that kind of money that would be prohibited. The president spoke to the American Council on Education meeting in Washington also and said the atmosphere in the nation's capital is not very fundraiser friendly these days.
We're all in a lather up here in Washington these days about campaign contributions. Everybody hates them, but nobody wants to go to public funding. So we're deemed destined to some period of hand-wringing.
But advocates of tightening the campaign finance system bridled at that. They said that is a total cop-out and it's a way of abdicating responsibility. That's the quote in the Times from Fred Wertheimer, the president of Democracy 21, which is a public policy group. Then the Justice Department has subpoenaed the records of Johnny Chung, a California businessman who gave nearly $400,000 to the Democratic Party, and others who made large donations while seeking access to the White House. And the Times says the subpoena showed that the Justice Department task force is continuing to widen its investigation into alleged improprieties in the Democrats' drive to raise huge sums for last year's election. So the drip, drip, drip continues.
Tomorrow, Senator Chris Dodd's going to be on the I'm in the Morning program, unless he fakes his own death.
and he has not, and we would be surprised if he would.
And it'll be interesting to see what Senator Dodd, who hasn't been on anything since this story broke last week in the Boston Globe, placing him and a couple of those coffees there in the Oval Office, and particularly with apparently a guy from Connecticut, he's a senior senator from the state of Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
Who had some Libyan scam going on and gave $50,000 and expected something to get done, and apparently something did get done, but we don't know any of that. We're going to ask Senator Dodd those questions.
Yeah.
Here's the thing I like about Senator Dodd, and I was talking to Lobson Newberg yesterday, the extremely powerful a literary agent over to International Creative Management and my agent. And she said, well, you know, it's one of the things about Dodd is, you know, he will answer the question.
He'll stand up.
Yeah. But we'll see, won't we?
Yeah, we'll find out.
Absolutely, we will.
My advice to Senator Dodd would be, Senator, that with each question I ask you, simply say, Fowler did it. Fowler being the...
Donald Fowler.
Yeah. Donald Fowler, the co-chair of the DNC and the guy who... Well, I mean, I'll just blame everything on him.
Oh, certainly.
I don't know anything. I was out giving speeches, appearing on your show and on Meet the Press and on these other programs, and...
I had no idea what...
Going on talking to Sam and Cokie, and I didn't have time to know anything about this.
Purely a promoter. I mean,
Fowler was a guy talking to these Chinese men. But there's one little Chinese dude giving $400,000. You just hear Charles say that?
Mm-hmm.
Where do you think the little bastard got $400,000?
Hmm.
I mean, who can come up with $400,000 to do anything with? You know, let alone to give it to those...
lay on the DNC?
Well, let me tell you who's there. Absolutely, though, just... Well, as you know, I sort of like the president, but...
Yeah.
I'll tell you who's really a creep, and that's Al Gore. God, what a lion worm. And I can't believe you and I used to like him. That's what I can't... Remember that? How you and I used to think what a great guy he was, and what a straight shooter, and it turns out he's just the worst person on Earth. Like, there's not the worst person on Earth, but he's close. He's so absolutely phony.
A little disingenuous with the tobacco stuff.
Oh, that, I mean, that's not the half of it. A sand trap head looking weasel. Really, I mean, just a horrible person. You know, who he's worse than?
Who?
He's worse than that guy from Missouri. What's that congressman's name? He always thinks he's going to run for president, the redheaded guy.
Oh, Dick Gephardt?
Dick Gephardt. He has actually given a choice. Excuse me. Given a choice of voting for somebody, I'd vote for Dick Gephardt before I'd vote for Al Gore.
That's quite an extension of the eye, man. Good grief.
And you'd have to hold a gun on me to vote for Dick Gephardt for anything. Let me just say this.
What?
I would vote for Chuck Robb.
Get out of here. Now
before
you're
I'd vote
far.
For Al Gore.
Now you're going too far.
All right, time for the national weather here on the Imus in the Morning program, sponsored by the Man's Hat Shop there in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
But
what?
But the president is interested in Dolly, the cloned sheep. I was going to get to that, I-Man. But go ahead. We'll get to that later.
We'll get to that in a moment.
Yeah, that's okay.
What does he want to do with the sheep?
I have no idea, but Mike McCurry has something to say about it, apparently. We have a cut.
Well.
But move ahead,
Don't you care about the weather?
Sure, I care about the weather desperately, in fact. What's it going to be?
Well, it's going to be fair throughout much of the West.
Okay.
Some rain and snow in northern Washington. Gusty winds up to 60 miles an hour there in California, Southern California.
Need a wool sweater.
Rain and snow in Arizona? New Mexico, Southern Colorado, big mess there, Chuck. That whole Four Corners area.
Horrible,
In Santa Fe, up around 36 with some snow and stuff. In Phoenix, rain possible. Los Angeles, pretty nice. Sunshine, a little wind there, that kind of deal. San Francisco, sunny and nice today, high around 66. Fat Dave on Channel 5 last night in San Francisco was eating asparagus.
And then reintroducing
some. You'd think this guy, Dave McElhan, whatever his name is, would be healthier. It's the anchor on Channel 5 News in San Francisco.
Yeah.
You'd think but he's not. He's just a big moose. So, I mean, he's a lovely guy, isn't it? I like their newscast. Fat Dave and Kate, they do the news, and I think they're great. But I actually do think they're good.
Mm.
But, I mean, Dave's got one of those rake-over deals with his hair, you know, where he's got a raked-over.
Thomas Puccio deal going for him.
Yes.
Okay.
That'll get the hose for him.
And he's just, you know, he's grotesquely overweight.
Belying the fact that he is often seen eating
there with a goofy grocer eating asparagus.
Mm.
Just on bottom.
It's all for show, probably that.
Gotta be.
Yeah.
In Dallas today, it'll be, I don't know, ugly situation, I think, in Dallas. The whole state of Texas looks like it's under clouds, you know?
Hmm.
Periods of rain in Dallas up around 45 degrees.
Well, funk that.
Indeed, funk that. And, here in New York, it's only going to be 32 degrees. In Boston, it's only going to be 27 degrees.
Oh, man.
The book of the week on the Imus Morning program is White Widow from Jim Lehrer, his novel. which is just wonderful. And Charles and I just love this book. Have you finished it yet?
I have not.
Well, that's not a good sign, is it, that you're...
Well, I could.
Have given up on it?
Connie just got home last night, and I was able to...
You can't read because your wife's gone?
Well, we had things that we had to catch up on.
I bet you did.
Been a week in, in absentia.
Well, it's published by Random House, and if it's not at your bookstore, tell a person at the bookstore how would they like it if you parked a U-Haul truck in front of their bookstore.
No. How would you like it if you picketed in front of their bookstore? Okay.
Tell them to order the book.
Jeez.
From Random House. Jim Lehrer, yes, the same Jim Lehrer does the news on public broadcasting. This nitwit has written a novel that is just...
That is fabulous.
Fabulous.
And I'm serious.
About really. Jack Oliver, right?
Yep.
Jack Oliver is the bus driver.
And
drives it.
In Loretta.
His wife, Loretta. And they apparently have a happy marriage. Okay. Jack's driving a bus.
Yep.
And Loretta's home.
Mm-hmm.
And
things go awry.
And a white widow gets on the Trailways bus.
Uh-oh.
Good-looking woman. Looked like Ava Gardner.
Yes, sir. And he just
went nuts.
That's a current reference.
Well Ava that's Gardner the way Jack describes her.
Yeah, and Ava Gardner.
Describes her as looking like Ava Gardner.
Isn't she dead?
Well, yeah, but she was a lovely woman. Come on.
She looks a little bit like...
Betty Davis.
Yeah, Greta Garbo.
She looks a little like Sheryl Crow without the overbite.
A very appealing woman.
Yeah. Jack describes her as looking like Ava Gardner.
Yeah,
you bald-headed bastard!
What are we, idiots?
This is Jack's.
Who
generation.
Created Jack?
Jim Lehrer did.
Okay.
Well, this happens back in the 50s.
Yes,
the story happens back in the 50s.
It's a very logical reference, for crying out
loud. So what happens after she gets on a bus?
Well, it's an ugly situation.
Do they foxtrot in the rear or something?
No, they do the twist.
To some Glenn Miller tunes, or what's going on?
What's wrong with
I understand
that?
What you're saying.
What's wrong with that?
That's what
Come
on. Do.
Well, it's not a pleasant time for Jack.
No. Things...
As it's not going to be a pleasant time for you two at our at the production meeting this morning.
Hope Ava Gardner's there.
You see, here's what I'm working with. I'm working with just two illiterates. You know?
Oh, dear.
You two are the dumbest bastards.
Was Gary Chapman playing in the background?
You leave Gary Chapman alone. We're getting nowhere with Brian Williams here on the Armstrong Morning Program. Mr. Williams anchors the news on MSNBC. Who's going to be the new guy for NBC, Mick Leshefsky?
I don't know.
You can
only
hope it's him, right?
He's been in the job. Boy, we are...
Tom has to introduce him all the time.
We are good buddies, and we shared that little tiny cubicle in the West Wing for a long, long time. And
don't you hope that?
Every trip, he's a very good guy. Jim Mick Leshefsky, known to many of us for good reason as Mick.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
How about Kenneth Starr?
How about Kenneth Starr and Riddick Bowe?
I'm going to Malibu. I'm not going to Malibu. I'm going to the Marines. I'm not going to the Marines. Marines was too regimented. Memo to Riddick Bowe. I think he got the Four Seasons West Palm brochure and the Marine Corps recruitment brochure transposed in his briefcase.
Good morning, Harvey.
Hello, Americans. Stand by for news. And as always, the rest of the story. Say, you want to play Whatever Happened To with me?
Sure.
You won't need your thinking cap for this one, because here it comes at you, slow floater the size of a malignant matzo ball. Whatever happened to Dr. Henry Kissinger?
Yeah.
Answer, sadly, nothing. Oh, do you remember him? Hank,
yeah.
Dunce of a diplomat, globe-trotting, Nixon-kneeling bimbo bopper, with that voice like dragging roofing nails down a blackboard?
Right.
Ah, now you've got it. Sick as we all are of him, barf bag buddy, he's still out there. Every time something global occurs, the vultures of histrionics who perch on the news assignment desks of our world send every Stone Phillips sap who cowers before them off to get a word from Henry Kissinger. Well, who cares? Sadat's gone. Begin's gone. Why, oh, why, Henry, aren't you? Page two.
Yeah.
Here's what happened now, Flashpoint pal. Deng Xiaoping, China lad, Marlboro mutt.
Yeah.
Well, he died, finally, and reporters... like your knee responding to that little rubber doctor's mallet, caromed off to see what Henry Kissinger thought. Well, this was it. That in Deng Xiaoping's passing, mankind had lost a great reformer. Henry, 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 what did he reform other than the mortuary market? For goodness sake, I guess Henry would do a Weekend at Bernie's thing with him, if he had his way. Yeah. And drag Mr. Dung to the White House to let our lip-biting president pound the Medal of Freedom into his chest. After all, what's one more Chinaman at a White House where they've already replaced the Rose Garden with a Zen Garden? Page three, say, citizens, were you wondering who's Kissinger now? I'll tell you, Madeleine Albright. You know her? Oh, no, no, I don't mean in the Pamela Harriman biblical sense. Though with this administration, I understand why you'd wonder.
Fine.
I meant, are you aware of Ms. Albright?
Yeah.
Got the same job Kissinger once had, Secretary of State, and Jewish, turns out. In fact, just like Kissinger. Dumpy, smart, beard. Now then, that Jewish thing. Well, therein lies a stale bagel or two, guilt buffs. You see, Madeleine Albright, nay, Madeleine Corbell, has found a couple of Jews in the profile.
Uh-oh.
Oh, she didn't know it, Pesach pal, until about 10 minutes ago, she tells me.
Fine.
Although, sure looks like a lot of folks tried to tell her about it over the years.
Mm-hmm.
So you know what impression we're left with?
No.
That another tip-top officer of you-know-whose administration embarks upon her new duties in classic Clinton clauses.
Huh?
Oh, that means lying.
Yeah.
As in a big fat denial of Moses and noses. Say, it should be interesting when Ms. Albright has to scoot off to Israel on official business, why, she'll need a Henry Kissinger shuttle mission just to get permission to land. And, of course, a forklift to haul our fat fibber off the plane.
Fine.
Oh, say, you hear who's planning a trip to Israel? Pope, Johnny Paul, next year? Vatican's already talked to Netanyahu's people. Official word? Delighted. And already they have their eyes, they say, already have their eyes on two thieves and a goalpost. Paul Harvey, good day.
I'm not uncomfortable talking to anybody, but I just didn't feel qualified to talk to Muhammad Ali, frankly. Walking in with his cowboy hat on, he looks at you and says, get out of my life.
Who's this old lady in a cowboy hat talking to me?
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
Good morning, champ. Oh, don't do man, that.
Come on, Mr. Chomp.
Disgusting.
I'm disappointed you're not going to be interviewing Mr. Chomp.
Well?
Because between him and his condition and you being deaf, that would have been one damn interesting 60 minutes.
What?
Champ, what do you say was your greatest triumph? Zappa, Zappa, Zivo. What? Zappa, Roll. What? Excuse me, what? You two have a lot in common.
Yeah.
Each of you achieved the pinnacle of his respective field. You're both cultural icons. And neither one of you has a clue what's going on.
In the morning. Well, that's unfortunate. We have a thermostat here, and they put a box around it and locked it so that the morons in here can't touch it.
Uh-huh.
Because it either gets too hot or gets too cold here.
That's unbelievable.
And I told them yesterday to give me a key.
Right.
And they told me they only had one key.
Mm-hmm.
And until they could have another key made. Well, I said, fine, I took the key they have. Now I have the key.
Aren't you one of the morons they don't want to touch it?
Now I have the key, and if somebody wants a temperature change, they can call me in Manhattan, and I'll come over and change it for them. Or I'll have Dana go have a key made, or the fat intern.
Sure. Yeah. You can clone a sheep, you can clone a key. I'll be Dana.
Absolutely. All right, here's Warner Wolf. Good morning, Warner.
Good morning, I'm
According to the Washington Post, Riddick Bowe was thrown out of the Marines.
Get out!
He did not leave voluntarily.
No. I feel tired right now.
Said Marine Corps Major Rick Long, there were occasions when Bowe was asked to perform his duties, but he refused to train.
Good idiot.
Boy. I'm tired.
I can hear it now. Hey, come on. What do you mean, get out of bed? Let me sleep. March? Hey, man, I don't march. I have a Rolls Royce. Clean my shoes, make my bed. Come on.
Give me 20.
I would have brought my maids. Peel potatoes? Come on. Where's my cook?
I want some fries.
The Atlanta Falcons picked up veteran quarterback Chris Chandler from the Oilers for two draft picks. Have ball, will travel.
Do you know where they got him from?
From the Oilers.
Yeah, wherever.
The 31-year-old Chandler's been with the Colts, Tampa, Rams, Cardinals, Oilers, and now the Falcons.
Good Lord.
Old Cowboys never die. They can always go to the Dolphins. Ex-Cowboy defensive back Clayton Holmes, suspended by the NFL for substance abuse last November and released by the Cowboys 3 weeks ago, has been picked up by his former Cowboy coach Jimmy Johnson and the Dolphins.
Wow.
Hooray for the National Football League.
Hooray!
Yay!
The word is the owners' meeting in March next month may pass the new NFL replay rule. Each coach would get two videotape replay timeouts per half. If they're wrong, they lose a timeout. The three challenges would be involving plays in the end zone, sidelines are out of bounds, or number of players on the field. The only thing wrong with this is, by limiting the videotape replay to scoring plays, what about an 80-yard disputed pass to the one-yard line?
Absolutely.
That sets up the scoring play. Come on.
Very good. What about
that? That's it. What about it?
What about that?
That's it. NBA last night, the Spurs lost to Charlotte.
What?
That's right.
Now, what did you say, Charles? What did you say?
When?
I said, oh, come on here. Just answer the question. What did you just say?
I honestly don't know why. Did I say something?
Did you mutter under your breath there?
I possibly
swear
did.
Word?
I don't know. I was simply exhorting Mr. Wolf.
It sounded as though you said, son of a bitch. That's what it sounded like.
I might have. I might have. Because
did you learn that at your Bible study class?
No, but I was exercised at the moment. I was in the floor of the thing.
Is that what you say at the Bible study class when one of the tricks Jesus tries doesn't work?
No, of course. Tricks?
Well, you know, when he fixes up one of them lepers or something.
Well, what's wrong with that?
Nothing. No, I didn't say there was anything wrong with it.
No.
Can you answer any question? Why don't you run for office?
Of course I can answer a question. I just answered your question. I answered your question.
Todd, you asked him, what did you say? And he says, when...
Right.
Well, you know what I was talking about, you bastard.
What were
you?
Hey. Where did you learn that kind of discussion, I'm at?
I'm not running down to some Bible study class.
Are you running for office?
No, I'm not.
Perhaps you should consider it.
Well, I don't think we need to be muttering under our breath.
Well, if I did, it was an accident.
Wouldn't
but
wonder.
I don't know that I did. We don't know that.
Play the tape back, Lou.
Well, I don't think it's necessary to play a tape.
Oh,
back.
I do.
Well, that's silly. Now you're being silly.
Be quiet. It'll take a while to get the
tape,
obviously.
I know it. It's an unnecessary waste of time.
No, I'd like to hear it. Give me part of that. What is that?
It's a bagel.
Let me have just part of it.
Just tear
off a little piece of it.
For crying out loud.
Just tear off and tear
I'm
that in half.
I'm going to tear it, for
get
God's sake. Here.
Be quiet.
Tear this.
Grow hair.
Which half do you want?
Iron your face.
You want left or right?
Let me hear it. Hey.
The word is the owners' meeting in March next month may pass the new NFL replay rule. Each coach would get two videotape replay timeouts per half. If they're wrong, they lose a timeout. The three challenges would be involving plays in the end zone, sidelines are out of bounds, or number of players on the field. The only thing wrong with this is, by limiting the videotape replay to scoring plays, what about an 80-yard disputed pass to the one-yard line?
Absolutely.
That sets up
what
the scoring play. Come on.
Very good. What about
that's
that?
That's it. What about it?
What about that?
That's it.
Son of a
NBA last night, the Spurs.
Weird.
Eagle ear.
Stop the tape. Didn't even mumble. What's the matter with you?
I don't know that was my voice.
Oh,
come on.
Well, get out of here. You sound like Bill Clinton.
Now you've gone too far. I don't think there can be any case made.
To not swear while Warner trying to do sports.
At this point in time, but that was in fact my voice.
Oh, come on here. Go ahead, Warner.
In the NBA, the Spurs lost to Charlotte. After the game, Spurs guard Avery Johnson.
I just hope when we get back healthy again, and we have 13 healthy guys, that we can play as hard as this grade 8, as I call it, that run out there every night.
13 guys? Come on, Avery, you're only allowed 12.
What's with that?
What is this?
Idiot.
Well,
13, there are no 13 guys.
Well, he's a little confused, Warner.
Kansas goes 28-1, barely beating Oklahoma 70-68.
What was the final score?
70-68.
Well,
what did he just say?
Well, but they were big.
What was the final score?
70-68.
Okay, so move on.
If you had Kansas and gave three, you lost.
Well, yes, but I mean, they won.
Yeah, but they didn't beat the spread.
What was the final score?
70-68.
They won.
They didn't beat.
They were supposed to win by
more than that.
They won.
If you took out the spread,
the spread doesn't count. The spread's not going to get them to the NCAA.
But look at all the people that wouldn't be interested in the game if there was no spread.
I don't care about them. I don't care about them. We are not catering to like you, Warner, to people, to the mob. My wife saw you up on the Upper West Side. of Manhattan yesterday. Here's what Deidre told me. She said, I saw Warner Wolf with two people who, frankly, looked like gangsters.
I was alone.
Okay, well, here's what my wife said. My wife said she saw Warner Wolf on the street corner.
Yeah.
And two guys that looked like they had just walked out of Goodfellas handed Warner a briefcase. And my wife said it looked to her like there was money in it, one of those Halliburton silver briefcases. Mm-hmm.
Now, who are you going to believe, me or your wife?
I'm going to believe my wife. So. Anyway, it was 33 years ago today.
Right.
That Muhammad Ali defeated Sonny Liston. Sonny Liston, they fought in Miami, Florida for the heavyweight championship of the world. And Muhammad Ali predicted he'd whoop him in five, actually. And Sonny Liston did not come out for the seventh round.
Correct.
Why?
He said his shoulder was hurt, yet any tape in the film show that he was still throwing punches with his shoulder.
Yeah.
The other three theories, one was the shoulder, two was, at that time, that the black Muslims had gotten to Liston and threatened him.
Yeah.
The third theory was Liston had lost so much to the mob and gambling.
He lived in Las Vegas, you know.
That he took a dive.
Yeah.
But it is possible that none of those theories are true, and Ali just beat him.
Yeah. Of course, and then the second fight.
The Phantom Punch.
Yeah.
Lewiston, Maine.
Yeah.
Which was postponed because of a hernia injury to Ali.
Right. Well, if not ego, I guess. 33 years ago today.
Yeah,
I'll be darned.
Muhammad Ali, Sonny Liston. All of them.
Good grief.
That's the deal.
Yep.
February 25th, 1964.
We were named after our slave masters when we first was brought to America. We were robbed of all knowledge of ourselves. If I said, here comes Mr. Chang Chong, you'd pitch your Chinaman. If I said, here comes Mr. Khrushchev, you look for Russian. If I said, here comes Mr. Goldberg, you look for Jew. If I said, here comes Mr. White Cloud, you look for Indian. If I said, here comes Mr. Castro, you look for Cuban. Here comes Mr. Lumumba, Mr. Kenyatta, you look for African, a black man. Now, what's your last name?
I'm a in the morning.
Well, 1964.
For an idiot.
The I-Man is hanging off that Southern Pacific freight train. Main line, wasn't that deal? I don't want to tell that now. I remember that. And old Tony Kanza was out there in Hoboken, New Jersey, making the first Blimpy sub sandwich. And he said, man, I'm onto something here. Blimpy, God, what a great sandwich. Have you ever tried one of them? Well, they're everywhere now. Blimpy, it is a beautiful thing. The ancient Greeks left us with wild tales of the women's called Amazons. But nobody believes them. Today's New York Times reports there may be something to those stories. Archaeologists, they found what may be their graves. How about this?
Lord.
But even if they are not the women who'd would rather get it on than rather make war than love, then, I don't know, read the New York Times. God, leave me alone.
Imus!
Yeah, good morning.
Imus in the morning. It's 22 minutes till the hour, and on the I-line now, 1-800-370-IMUS. We tried to call Fred out in Santa Fe, but can't get no answer from Fred. He's probably feeding horses or something.
Yeah.
Here's Dave, David from Rosebud, Arkansas.
Hi there.
Hi, David. How are you?
Oh, man, I'm doing fantastic.
What are you doing down there in Rosebud?
Oh, well, I'm fixing to go to work. I'm a chemical salesman, and I travel central Arkansas. And but I was down in Searcy the other day and picked up some of Fred's hot stuff.
Yeah.
And man, it's really good stuff. I mean, I sat down and I ate the whole jar right there.
And did you have the hot or the medium, David?
I had the medium.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I couldn't find the hot in there. I think it all got sold out or something.
Mm-hmm.
And I got you on MSNBC.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I think you are a little bit more handsome than your brother.
Dave, what kind of call is this? What the hell is going on down there with you, Dave? You're not one of them queers, are you, Dave?
Oh, no. Oh, no. I don't wander too close behind the sheep or the goats or anything. Oh,
okay. Well, not, of course, that there'd be anything wrong with that, would there?
Oh, yeah. There's
some mighty pretty sheep out there.
Oh, right. I'll tell you what.
Mighty pretty queers there.
Yeah. I'll tell you what. You know, you can... get awful lonely out here in the woods, you know.
I'm sure you can, Dave. God almighty.
Well, that's why those little forest creatures run so fast.
Ainsley. They're rearing on golden, right?
Well, anyway, you call Fred out there in Santa Fe, New Mexico, 1-800-272-1957, and just like old Dave.
All righty.
Get yourself a couple of jugs of Fred's hot stuff. Well, it is good.
Yeah. All righty. Well, hey, I appreciate it.
All right, Dave, thanks.
Thank you.
Dave from Rosebud, Arkansas, calling up to suck up with the I-Man. Yep. It's just pathetic. So you can also get Fred's hot stuff at all Stop and Shop supermarkets. And you can buy turquoise buffalo tortilla chips at all Stop and Shop locations. And there's a few supermarkets that are better than Stop and Shop. I mean, just loves them. Also, Mel's Diesel Service out there in Lincoln, Nebraska, they've got it. Some Giant stores in Pennsylvania have Fred's Hot Stuff. Some Edwards supermarkets, you have to check and see. They're not very well organized, those folks. Clement Supermarket in Portsmouth, Rhode Island, they have it. Maggie's Mini Mart in Sioux City, Iowa, she's got it. Total Beverage locations, they're in Virginia. And, of course, Chris Ramsey down at Ramsey Nursery in Harrison, Arkansas, he's got it. So. And Fred's Hot Stuff and Turquoise Buffalo Tortilla Chips coming soon to Walmart. But it costs more than Tostitos or Paces on Rail Polo El Paso. And the reason it does, because it's not made with a bunch of frozen junk in it. It's not full of preservatives, and it's not got a bunch of artificial junk in it and chemicals to keep it hot and stuff. So it's all fresh vegetables. Fresh onions and tomatoes and peppers, and no water added, and no sugar, and no preservatives. What are you doing?
Fabulous stuff, as a matter of fact. What am I doing?
Well, I'm trying to talk to you, and you're sitting there reading, and it's 19 out to the hour. Laura Ingham is here ostensibly to talk politics.
Yes. I'm concerned about Fred, because I understand that he's not feeling well.
Leave my brother
and
alone.
I mean, Fred's not feeling well. Maybe he should stop drinking out of the dog's bowl. You know, that video phone that you guys have? Well, I kept thinking I had bad reception at home. No. I'm like, God, that's a lot of weird fuzz. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's Fred's face.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
President Clinton, while he's at this fundraiser, challenged Republicans to end their solicitation of soft money and also apologize for his having to return money in the past.
Well, I mean, congratulations, Mr.
That's
President.
That's like Lyle Menendez apologizing to Eric Menendez for not getting the first shot off fast enough. I mean, give me a break. I'm in the morning.
Good morning.
The late General George S. Patton, Jr.
At ease, as you were. We're taking a hard look today at some sorry excuses, people. Textbook examples of what I don't ever want you lean, mean, killing machines to become. And you know what that is, right? Let's hear it, warriors.
Sir, sissified sacks of sow secretion, sir.
I can't hear you.
Sissified sacks of sow secretion, sir.
That's better. Boy, do we ever have a couple of them today. Private, give me an Empire State Building Kodak moment on those lights and deploy the overhead projector. Cease fire. For God's sake, cease fire! Jesus. Somebody set up a triage station outside and let's move on.
All right,
Private. Let's see who today's sissified sacks of sow secretions are. Slide one. And let's test our identification proficiency by flashing the image on the screen for just 1 second. Ready? Flash. All right. Who was that sissified sack of sow secretion? Soldier?
Sir, that's Riddick Bowe, the boxer, sir.
Fine cognitive skills, young man. That was indeed Bowe, Riddick, fighter, prize, champion, world, and now champion wuss. An example of what you get when you dump 300 pounds of Double Dutch chocolate jello into an Al Sharpton jumpsuit and lace a pair of boxing gloves on it. A big, overgrown windbag that's all robe and no ring, who makes a federal case out of joining the Marine Corps and then quits. Quits, mind you, after 3 days of boot camp. And when? Right in the middle of Black History Month. Now, there's an item for the next Roots sequel. February 20th, 1997, Riddick Big Daddy Bo changes name to Riddick Big Baby Bo, runs home to family to pursue career of fetal position thumb-sucking sissy, and is heard to whine, "Why is Imus the only guy who gets roses from David Brudnoy?" Next slide. 1 second exposure. Identification. Yes, Private.
Sir, that sissified sack of cell secretions is Kenneth Starr, the human boomerang, sir.
You're on your game today, Private. That is indeed Starr, Kenneth, council independent and spineless academic. You people are familiar with rat in the box syndrome?
No.
Thump the box on one side, the rat runs to the other. Well, Council Starr, getting thumped for the Whitewater investigation heading toward the toilet, started to slink away as far as he could get and still stay in the contiguous 48 states, that paragon of pedagogy, Pepperdine University. Then, getting thumped for that, he fled back to the other side of the box, announcing he'd stay with Whitewater after all. Do everybody a favor, Mr. Starr. The next time you travel, book the Barnacle Bus and take the son of a bitch off the bridge to the next century, along with the principal subject of your case, that pantload who has the temerity to call himself our commander-in-chief. Riddick Bowe and Kenneth Starr, the main event, pansies in panties, or hitting below the beltway. Yeah. Somebody's going down, if you get my drift, as we go from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Provincetown, Massachusetts. Thank you for your attention. That is all.
All right, here now with observation and comment on headline issues of the day. From the hood, I'm in Washington, Snoop Doggy Dog.
I think it's about time for me to hit these up against the upside of their head with some of that West Coast gangster shit. Oh, wait.
This dog got the scent and it's sniffing around, and it like to make a circle before it drop one on the ground. Take off my doggy leash, I'm gonna make a speech. Sit down, shut up, Snoop Dogg gonna preach. Who knew Brother Bo would be rotten to the core, just cause the Marines wouldn't like the brochure. So Riddick comes marching home again, not as a veteran, but a civilian. As a pugilist, he may still be a champ, but you can't be a soldier unless you make it through boot camp. The regimented training someone out of his league. He found the reason why they call them close fatigues. And the Bo is energetic and athletic. Drill sergeants ain't known for being all that sympathetic. Big Daddy may be good in a brawl, hit a man so hard that he'd fall, but basic training made the little baby ball. To the U.S. Marines, he's just like Oliver McCall. It gonna be hard to get himself another title bout in uniform selling cookies with the Girl Scouts.
Hey,
scary news coming from the world of science. The laws of Mother Nature in defiance. They successfully cloned themselves a mammal. Right now it's just a sheep. Next it's gonna be a camel. This discovery may be a little shocking, but shows a bunch of happy slurpy jockeys. It's bad for a man to play with the building blocks of DNA. Cause if these mad scientists have their way, they make living human beings out of paper mache. Stop the madness now, I'm giving y'all fair warning before somebody clones Don Imus in the morning.
Morning news time is 5 minutes past the hour. Snoop, Richard Nixon, and Beavis and Bubba, and we're trying to get a hold of Fred Imus when it happened to him off the scope.
Yeah.
And we got a Bo Dietl cut coming up, right, Chuck?
Yes, we do.
So here's Charles with the news. Good morning, Charles.
Good morning, I-Man. A poll by ABC's Nightline indicates that 8 in 10 Americans believe it would be wrong to clone human beings, but most respondents accept the cloning of animals for medical research. That's okay. Mm-hmm. The survey follows news that scientists in Scotland have cloned a lamb from an adult sheep.
Could have cloned that dog ears, Bud.
In fact, they could, and perhaps even from supposedly from dead material.
From the DNA of your dead dog?
Yeah, which brings it, you know, there are some people even suggesting that the Jurassic Park idea actually could be brought about.
Did you have your dog cremated?
Yes. Yeah.
Well, you're pretty much ruled out then.
I suppose so, because it's now in a little box, you know, on a shelf.
Where's the box?
It's at home.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
Oh, you have a box with your dog's ashes in it at your house?
Well, sure. I mean, people keep
sick. What's wrong
keep
with
their
you?
Relatives in urns and that sort of thing. And
sick.
Bud's on a shelf. Got Bud on a shelf.
No, you don't.
Yes, we do.
Why?
What's wrong with that? I mean, it's in a little memoriam thing. You know.
Oh, Jesus. There's something wrong with you.
Well, Mrs. McCord wanted it, basically.
Probably cigar ashes.
Very close to. No, it's not cigar ashes. It's old Bud. That's all. I don't see that that's so preposterous. But you're having trouble with it, I can tell.
Well, I guess it's fine.
It is. It's fine.
Dog's ashes in a box.
White House Press Secretary Mike McCurry says President Clinton is very interested in Dolly, the cloned sheep.
I'll bet.
A presidential panel has been appointed to weigh the ethical implications and will get back to the president about Dolly in 90 days.
The White House has asked the advisory commission to review that, to make a judgment as to whether we really need to focus more clearly on some of the dimensions.
Pull this guy up. Jesus.
Well, it raises huge ethical questions, I know.
Nobody cares.
Well, people care deeply.
Nobody cares.
Everybody is stunned over the cloning of Dolly and the possible implications.
Not everybody's nothing.
The Empire State Building is due to reopen its 86th floor observation deck this morning, but with extra security measures in place, metal detectors, and also the same sort of device used to scan baggage at airports.
Where's
so
the Bo Deedle thing?
It's coming up.
Okay.
So that no one will be able to get up to the 86th floor observation deck any further with any sort of weapon.
Why wasn't this done earlier?
Well, I don't know. It's a case of course, closing the barn door after the horses are gone. So. And it was anti-terrorism expert and former New York City homicide detective Bo Deedle speaking out about a group calling itself the Army of God on ABC somewhere. Yeah, it appeared on Good Morning America, but it may have been something that was simply brought forward from an appearance on the news last night. The Army of God has claimed responsibility for two recent bombings in Atlanta, one at an abortion clinic, the other this weekend at a gay nightclub. And here's what Mr. Deedle had to say on national television this morning.
The Army of God is a offshoot of the abortion movement, but this is the real radical movement. And now they've teamed up with militia groups from the Midwest, and they now have these grouped together, which is very, very violent.
Do you recognize that particular observation from...
No, we're going to have to get
evening?
To the bottom of this. We'll further investigate. This warrants further investigation.
Maybe getting some deedle jive?
No, but this warrants further investigation.
All right. Marianne Mauney of the Center for Democratic Renewal, a group which tracks hate crimes, says she is skeptical that this Army of God even exists, and thinks the bombings could be the work of one person who has taken the Army of God name.
Maybe Tom Brokaw has some suspects in mind. We should interview him.
I don't get that.
Richard Jewell?
Oh, shut up. All right, here now, live from Boston, Massachusetts, is Mike Barnicle. Good morning, Mr. Barnicle.
Hey, what's the big deal about this cloning story? Do you understand what the big deal is all about?
No.
I mean, the Zen Master... And MSNBC cloned a horse's ass about 7 months ago. Dawn every morning. I mean, would you stop beating up on Charles? I don't like this.
This is what did I do to Charles?
You were beating up on him last hour about, you know, what he said or didn't say and trying to embarrass him, playing a tape back. Grow up. Now stop this.
He was swearing during Warner's sportscast.
And leave Warner alone, by the way, too. If you pick on Warner and you pick on Charles, you lose!
Get a job and stop calling us.
See you later.
Mike Barnicle from the Boston Globe and a NewsHour with Jim Laird with clearly nothing to do.
Just the idle time.
God, just riding around in his Mercedes.
Drunk.
Drunk, clearly. All right, here's Bo Deedle again now. Good morning, Mr. Deedle.
Hey, Spider, get me a drink. What made you comprehensitate that I was on Good Morning? I don't do morning shows. I don't get up that early.
Well, we had an erroneous report from our news editor, Jane Metzler.
Yeah, Jane Metzler. You know what you should clone is that guy, Michael Jordan Shaft, man.
What's wrong with you?
Holy
cow. Where are you?
I'm driving up to Albany. I go see the governor. Oh. You know, I'm the chairman.
I understand that.
The chairman.
Yes.
Yeah.
I understand that.
But this is true about this. They put out a manual, 133-page manual, this Army of God.
No.
And in the manual, they show how to make all these bombs. I got a copy of the manual.
Mm-hmm.
And they give this out. And on the cover, it has a little girl with a teddy bear and says, save me or something. Yeah, go plant the bomb with some nails and kill some innocent people,
yeah,
but save the little girl on the cover. So this group is an offshoot of these anti-abortion groups.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens now, they mergitated with this militia group, and they taught each other how to make these bombs,
yeah,
and it could be very, very possible that that's where the problem's coming from down there in Atlanta, and it could happen, it could pop up anywhere in the country, because they don't have any idea of the numbers of them. The FBI has no ideas of the numbers of this group. It's a real radical group.
Well, I hope we get to the bottom of it here.
Well, we're on the case, they Commander Johnson Rod.
Bo Diddle here on the Virus of the Morning program, clearly. Just
drinking,
you know,
with Barnacle.
Both of them drunk in Bo's Cadillac or something. I don't know what the hell they're
together
doing.
Together. It's kind of a titty bar.
Hey, you call him that.
This'll kill. A horse's ass.
Get it?
Well, I mean, what are they both thinking about?
Michael Jordan share.
COVID yet.
Like Dennis from Boston.
Exactly.
All three of them drunk in a car.
In Dennis's taxi cab.
Yeah. Dennis is laughing at them.
Nah, what else, Charles?
Just a couple things, I man. The Washington Post, in its reliable source column in the style section this morning, reports that Senator Edward Kennedy just loves getting into costume and apparently dresses up at the staff parties he has every year at Christmas, and did so over the weekend on the occasion of his 65th birthday.
Yeah.
Senator Kennedy donned tights and came dressed as Ponce de Leon, complete with black hair, plumed hat, and mustache, while wife Victoria Reggie, who turns 43 years old tomorrow, came dressed as the Fountain of Youth, complete with silver streamers in her hair, and I guess a fine time was had by all.
Oh, you think anybody was drinking in time of
No way. Now, stop it.
She dress up in a scuba diver's outfit.
That would be fine. I don't think we need to go there.
He wouldn't need a weight belt, though, would he?
No.
I guess not. Jurors in the John DuPont murder trial are moving into day 7 of deliberations. Prosecutor Patrick Meehan says the panel apparently is making progress, but he's looking ahead to a possible retrial in case there is a hung jury. And the CIA reportedly told the Army, I-Man, that U.S. soldiers could have been exposed to Iraqi chemical weapons, chemical agents, in 1991.
Sure.
The New York Times has recently declassified documents undermined the Pentagon's repeated assertion that it was unaware of the possible exposure until last year.
What, to spray a bunch of nerve gas on you?
Times says the Army failed to conduct a thorough investigation, and the information was simply put aside for more than 4 years.
No, I can't believe that. Just something like that would happen, can you?
No, not at all.
No, 14 after the hour now. All right, here now with a comment and observation on headline issues of the day. I'm in Washington's senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Yes, indeed. And thank you, Imus in the Morning, as always, for keeping the dope alive. A little self-deprecating humor to indicate what a fine fellow I truly am.
Please.
Issue 1, speaking of my immeasurable contributions to the community of man, J.D., 25 years ago, Dick Nixon, in concert with Henry Kissinger, traveled to China and broke the bamboo barrier. 25 years later, Bill Clinton, in concert with Chris Dodd, and while sitting on his fat duff in Washington, D.C., did to China what Paula Jones wouldn't do to him and broke the bamboo bank, for Christ's sake. Jesus, I mean, Clinton is doing stuff that even I wouldn't do for money. Okay. But for crying out loud, let's just say that Hong Kong ain't the only place that's about to be taken over by China, huh? We've already got a fat boater sitting behind the desk in the Oval Office, and Gore is clanging cymbals about one step away from hassling people at airports. So it was little wonder to me that I spotted this headline. Deng's death won't alter ties with China. Well, hell no, it won't. They've got a joint banking account with the Democratic National Committee. So Madeleine Albright was surprised to find out that there are Jews in her family tree. But neither she nor anybody else is going to be surprised to find Chiang Kai-shek and Confucius hanging out of Bill Clinton's. by the way, I don't know if you heard, but Ms. Albright said that it also came as a complete surprise to her when she was informed this morning that she is a girl, having been told for years by her parents that she was a short, long-haired guy who like to dress up in his mom's clothes. Just tell it like it is, Madam Secretary. Give me a break. Oh, back if I may to that great humanitarian Dung for just a moment.
Yeah.
First world leader ever, Iman, whose place of interment has been prepared not with the traditional backhoe, but with the non-traditional, but more appropriate, pooper scooper. Thought the little turd would never die. Well, that's it, Dono. Our look through the Dick scope this morning. The view, that of Dick Nixon, a man who just wishes that he'd had sense enough to get on that chow mein train back there when he himself was the president of the United States.
We're talking with Butterbean, who's going to fight. Well, he doesn't know he's going to fight. He doesn't care either.
Yeah.
Did you see that Oliver McCall fight the other night?
Oh, I loved it.
Oh, come on, man.
You know, you got to love a guy that can go out there and cry.
Yeah.
And still, you know, almost three rounds crying,
yeah,
and not get knocked out. You gotta love that.
Well, we were talking earlier. Oh, man, that's cold.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
But you might have, did you feel sorry for him at all?
No, I didn't. Not a bit.
I mean, you got to say this about you, and that is that if you're going to do what you do, you might as well have your attitude.
Exactly. You know, the guy starts crying, you whack him even harder.
Give him something to cry about.
That's right. I mean, don't stand there.
On,
oh, my God, he's crying. I'm getting scared now. What is this?
Imus in the morning.
Good morning.
They are here in New York, and I'm Imus in the morning, and now live in Santa Fe, New Mexico.
Uh-oh.
The goober in the family, Fred Imus. Good morning, Fred.
Hey, what's going on?
So,
how you doing?
They don't make it clear to me over at Villard, Random House, the people who are doing our photo book. I never can get a straight answer from them. See,
yes.
I think all along that they're going to scan these slides and, you know, make this photography book that way. I did not know that they were going to make photographic separations and actually make prints and then scan those, which is the way they make, it's the way you would do any photography book.
Yeah.
If I had known that,
would you have done?
I'd have had Ken Lieberman do it.
Sure. Can you hold on while I get on the edge of my seat, I'm in?
So I'm very irritated, Fred.
Well,
I'm going to get that little midget pygmy agent of ours,
yeah, right.
Lobster Newberg, on the phone this morning.
That bitter little hedgehog.
That bitter little hedgehog, bridge troll, Esther Newberg.
Yeah.
I'm counting on her to get me another big advance after Lubica finishes this book. You be nice to her.
A two-legged cold shower.
Yeah. The Fred book will be out in November from Doubleday.
Yep.
Michael Lupica and Fred Imus. Actually, I guess it's going to say the Fred book by Fred Imus with Mike Lupica.
Yeah.
But Lupica wrote it.
A collaboration.
Right. It's not a collaboration. Lupica. Not at all. It's not a collaboration at all.
Not even begun to be.
I'm anxious to read it.
What?
See what I say?
Yeah, I'm anxious to hear what I had to say about it.
You're surprising every page.
Well, here's what Lupica did. Lupica has interviewed my brother on a variety of topics.
Yes.
And then has essentially written down what Fred said.
Exactly.
Except, now just think about it a minute.
What?
If Lupica called Fred and simply wrote down what Fred said, what would we have?
Well,
we'd have mostly what we have when we talk to Fred in the morning, nothing.
Garbage, yeah.
We'd have what? We'd have peeing on the dog's head, and that'd be basically it.
And
rambling.
Two lost melons.
Yes.
That's it.
So, obviously, we're having a great deal of input here from Lupica.
So between, me a nightmare last night.
So between Lupica and Fred, I suspect that between the two of them, they can come up with a funny book.
With one funny book,
Kind of a nightmare to have.
I believe I had a dream that some mad scientist cloned Laura Ingraham. And then I turned the TV on and somebody's already done it in Scotland.
Oh, you know.
You're an idiot.
Good
oh,
one.
God. I mean, how do you deal with that?
That book's going to be great.
You see, here's the thing. And then every time Laura Ingraham makes fun of you, you get all upset and you say horrible things about her.
I've never said a horrible thing about her.
Well, I don't think that's that's an especially positive thing
it's
to
not
say. Not flattering. She looks like a sheep.
Well, she accuses me of drinking out of a dog dish.
Well, I think there's probably some basis in fact for that.
You look like somebody cloned the Austrian Iceman.
Yeah, exactly. Man, what are you talking about? Well, how do you feel, Fred?
I feel great.
Well, I thought you had pneumonia.
No, I don't have pneumonia. have a little bronchitis.
I mean, it's just a...
Who's the lucky girl?
Now, you see, this,
this is just... this is sad.
Now, sad. This could be the book.
This is the book.
If not for... So here's a... Lupicus challenges to take a conversation like this with this idiot brother of mine and try to make something out of it.
Or just throw it out and make it up.
Well, I think Lupicus is mostly going to go through some of his old columns.
Well, he's going to have to.
Imus in the morning at 2020 Sports. Let the wolf go forth at this time and place. Here's Warner.
Did you say water?
You bastard.
Well, Breen's on the road. Warner's here. Good morning, Warner.
All right. Good morning, I-Man. According to the Washington Post, Riddick Bowe was thrown out of the Marines.
That's it.
Come on, get him out. Ooh. Said Marine Corps Major Rick Long, there were occasions when Bowe was asked to perform his duties but refused to train.
Oh, man.
But the real reason for Bowe being thrown out of the Marines...
There we go.
He couldn't understand how he could be in the same room with 75 other guys and still be called private.
I hate that.
God, that's horrible.
The New York Jets are looking more and more
shouldn't
like
have
the...
Shouldn't been an indication when you did that 2 hours ago that that's that wasn't
right.
That great.
It starts today.
I mean, no.
It starts today.
Nobody laughed two
Don't
hours
bring,
ago, Warner.
Warner, you idiot. Don't bring them back. Get out of the studio.
Out. Go ahead, Warner.
The future is now. The New York Jets are looking more and more like the New York Giants.
Yeah.
Jets coach Bill Parcells has brought back one of his two-time Giants Super Bowl linebackers, Pepper Johnson.
PJ.
Who's only about 40 years old.
Can Lawrence Taylor be far behind?
No.
Get him out of rehab.
God.
Bad news for Spurs guard Vernon Maxwell. Maxwell has been ordered by a Houston judge to pay almost $600,000 to a Houston woman who claimed Maxwell gave her genital herpes.
Great.
Didn't Laurie McNichol sue Fred for the same thing?
The woman says Maxwell gave her herpes, fully knowing the high risk of transmitting the disease, failed to take precautions, or inform her of his condition. The judgment includes $200,000 punitive damages and $400,000 medical, physical, and mental damages. NBA last night, the Bulls, Charlotte, and Orlando all won, and the Hawks beat the Warriors. After the game, Hawks coach Lenny Wilkins.
I mean, it was like we were going to score with our offense, and, we just can't play that way because we're too good a defensive team.
Come on, what's the offense supposed to do?
Exactly.
Well, what did he mean
score.
By that? He must have meant something.
Well, actually meant they win a lot of games because their defensive team keep the score down.
Oh, okay. So you're just making fun of me.
Yeah.
So you're like Breen, you're just ridiculing
these
guys.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Apparently Dodger all-star catcher Mike Piazza may wear a hockey goalie-type catcher's mask this year.
What?
The same style that Texas catcher Charlie O'Brien wore last year. The problem is, however, every time Piazza wears the mask, he suddenly picks up a bat, steps in front of the plate, and tells the batters to get out of the crease. And if you had Riddick Bowe storming the shores of Tripoli, you lost. For Imus of the Sports, this is Warner Wolf.
Shut it on, FBR. Now we're in the eye.
Bubba, you watching the Grammys?
Sure, baby. I have to maintain my image as the hip happening president. Have to stay abreast of all the far out boss groovy jive.
You said breast.
I'm rooting for that little country girl, Leanne Rimes. She's got me all excited. She's up for blue.
That's blue as in the color, not as in the past participle of the verb.
Oh, she's gonna leave me holding my dangling participle, is she? Dirty little thing.
I like Alanis Morissette. I really dig a chick. They're like, we'll go down on you in a theater 1 minute, and the next, show up at your house with a Zippo and a can of lighter fluid.
Oh, yeah? After it's happened to you a couple of times, it sort of loses its appeal. Believe me. How about that Tracy Chapman? Give me one reason to stay here.
Give me one reason I should buy that record. Hey, Tracy, Coolio called. He wants his hair back.
There's Coolio. No, that's Busta Rhymes. Snoop Doggy Dogg. Oh, wait a minute. It's one of those dudes from A Tribe Called Quest.
Yeah, it's Tony Bennett. He must have gotten a new toupee.
Bitchin'.
Bubba, you're never going to be the hip-happening president if you keep using those old, out-of-date expressions.
You mean I can't use bitchin' anymore?
Not unless you're talking about Hillary.
Hey, there is Hillary.
No, that's Pavarotti.
You mean I Pavarotti last night?
Yeah!
Kiss me, my darling. Be mine tonight. Tomorrow will be too late. It's now or never. My love won't wait.
Of course, had Elvis lived in Pavarotti, they would have been about the same size. Trotter equipment. Let me talk to you about the Trotter treadmill, babies. Best treadmill on the planet. Y'all get yourself one. I'm just like Fred Imus has. In fact, I bought my brother a Trotter treadmill, and he's supposed to be working out on it. One of the best ways to get in shape with a treadmill, most effective way to burn fat, a treadmill, convenient, fun stuff. For more information on the name of the nearest Trotter dealer, call 1-800-TROTTER and get yourself a Trotter treadmill. Well, the ancient Greeks left us with wild tales of women called Amazons, but ain't nobody believed that. Today's New York Times reports there may be something to those stories. Archaeologists have found out what may be their graves, but even if these aren't the women who'd rather make war than love, their tombs have something new to say about the status of women among all them bunhumpers back there. Any old, not necessary. 1-800-NYTIMES. That's what I'm saying.
I got a new attitude.
Weekdays from 1 till 4, you have an appointment with the doctor. Dr. Laura Schlesinger on Real Talk. 1390 AM WRTK.
I hope so.
No, you can do it.
I have to.
Just get it done. You have all the research done?